Good morning. Welcome to Pakefield Church on Sunday, the 28th of February. It's the second Sunday in Lent. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. Hear our voice, O Lord, according to your faithful love. According to your judgment, give us life. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image, to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Blessed be the Lord, who has heard the voice of our prayer. Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy, and in our song will we praise our God. Blessed are you, God of compassion and mercy. To you be praise and glory forever. In the darkness of our sin, your light breaks forth like the dawn, and your healing springs up for deliverance. As we rejoice in the gift of your saving help, sustain us with your bountiful spirit and open our lips to sing your praise. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God forever. The night has passed, and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen. Our psalm is Psalm 22, verses 23 to 31. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you offspring of Jacob, glorify him. Stand in awe of him, all you offspring of Israel. For he did not despise nor abhor the affliction of the afflicted. He did not hide his face from me, but heard when I cried to him. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will pay before those who fear him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall worship before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. To him, indeed, shall all who sleep in the earth bow down. Before him shall bow all who go down to the dust, and I shall live for him. Posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord and proclaim his deliverance to a people yet unborn, saying that he has done it. Glory to the Father and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Give ear, O heavens, and I will speak, and let the earth hear the words of my mouth. May my teaching drop as the rain, my speech distill as the dew, as the gentle rain on the grass, and as the showers upon the meadow. For I will proclaim the name of the Lord. Ascribe greatness to our God, the rock. His work is perfect, for all his ways are just. A faithful God without deceit, just and upright is he. His degenerate children have dealt corruptly with him, a perverse and crooked generation. Do you thus repay the Lord, you foolish and senseless people? Is not he your father who created you, who made you and established you? Remember the days of old. Consider the years long past. Ask your father, and he will show you, your elders, and they will tell you. When the Most High gave the nations their inheritance, when he divided the children of earth, he fixed the bounds of the peoples according to the number of the children of God. For the Lord's own portion is his people, Jacob his allotted heritage. He sustained him in a desert land, in the howling waste of the wilderness. He shielded him and cared for him. He kept him as the apple of his eye. As an eagle stirs up its nest and hovers over its young, spreading out its wings, takes them and bears them aloft on its pinions. So the Lord alone did guide him, and no foreign god was with him. We now come to our Bible readings.
The first reading is from Genesis 17, verses 1 to 7, and then 15 to 16. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, "I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless. And I will make my covenant between me and you, and will make you exceedingly numerous." Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, "As for me, this is my covenant with you. You shall be the ancestor of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be Abram, but your name shall be Abraham. For I have made you the ancestor of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations for you, and kings shall come from you. I will establish my covenant between me and you, and your offspring after you, throughout their generations, for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your offspring after you." God said to Abraham, "As for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall give rise to nations. Kings of peoples shall come from her." The second reading is from Romans 4, verses 13 to 25. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If the adherents of the law are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us, as it is written, "I have made you the father of many nations." In the presence of God, in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist, hoping against hope, he believed that he would become the father of many nations, according to what was said, "So numerous shall be your descendants." But he did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was already as good as dead. For he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith, as to give glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he has promised. Therefore, his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now, the words "it was reckoned to him" were written not for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in him, who raised Jesus, our Lord, from the dead. who was handed over to death for our trespasses and was raised for our justification. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Have you managed in keeping abreast of the different laws and regulations we've had to abide to because of the coronavirus? I'm afraid I have found it all rather confusing. Just who am I allowed to be in a bubble with? Can I meet up with a friend outside? Can I take the dogs for a walk twice a day? If I have a mask on, can I get closer than 2 meters? One thing this crisis has shown me is how difficult it is to follow laws which restrict normal behaviour. And in so doing, I now have a greater perception into the problems that the Jews had with following the Jewish law at the time of Jesus. The Jewish law also tried to restrict people's behaviour. It was the Pharisees whose job it was to rule on and enforce the laws. In the New Testament, they are often watching Jesus and challenging him when they thought he was breaking their laws. The fact that they could never win on a point of law against him was one reason why they were eager to get rid of him. As Christianity moved away from being just a Jewish sect and Gentiles, that is non-Jews, began to follow it, disputes began to happen over whether they would have to follow the Jewish laws and be circumcised to become Christians. It is actually quite ironic that it's Paul who supports the view that Gentiles did not have to follow the Jewish law. Paul had been the most fervent enemy of Christianity at the beginning, and he was one who would have never agreed to laying the law aside for Gentiles. But after he meets the risen Christ on the road to Damascus, he has a whole new take on what is really important. That day, he devotes himself with the same fervour as he once had employed in hunting Christians and begins planting churches all over the Roman world. By the time he's writing this letter to the Romans, it's 57 AD. He's in Corinth and he's planning the next phase of his campaign to tell the word about Jesus. He wanted to go to an area that knew nothing about the Lord, so that he could start from scratch in his mission to spread the word. His desire was to go to Spain, and in doing so, on the way, he could fulfill another ambition, which was to visit Rome. As a Roman citizen, Paul had always wanted to visit the city around the empire, and his letter to the Romans was his preamble before coming in person. He was to be disappointed, however, as it would be 3 years before he would get to Rome, and then it would be as a prisoner and not as a visitor. So in this letter to the Romans, Paul lays out his arguments and his reasons for what he believes is the most important part of the Christian faith. That we are all justified, which means to be made right with God, by grace and not through following the law. The Jewish leaders believed that the only way to be saved was to adhere to the law as given to Moses, and it had been added to over time. Only by doing so, by keeping the law, could a person be made pure and clean. The rules that the law laid down on people had to be strictly followed, or disaster would come down upon them. But they didn't see the law as a restriction, but as a comfort, because by following it to the letter, you would be safe and protected. But the problem was that it was impossible to completely adhere to the law all the time. There will always be situations that fall outside what the law says. Just think about going out for your loud exercise during lockdown and seeing two friends coming towards you. Do you ignore one and only speak to the other? and thus follow the law? Some things are just unrealistic to actually legislate against. So the Gentiles, the non-Jews, who had never had this much restriction in their lives, would have found it impossible to learn and to follow the law. And Paul knew that that was not what Jesus had intended people to do. Jesus said that he came to fulfill the law, not to destroy it. But he meant that by believing in him as the Messiah, that would make people right with God, in the same way as that the Jews had believed that keeping the law would do so. But in spite of what Jesus said, some Jewish Christians could not let go of the idea that keeping the Jewish law was important. Even today, some people find it very difficult to let go of traditions and customs they've followed since childhood. There's a comfort and security in routine and regularity, especially in troubled and unusual times. They wanted new Christians to at least follow the most important Jewish laws, those of circumcision and the food laws. But Paul, however, disagreed with imposing such restrictions on non-Jews. And in the letter to the Romans, he uses the argument that Abraham, who was seen as the father of nations, which included the Gentile nations, was chosen by God before the law was given to Moses, 300 or 400 years before. And thus Abraham's salvation did not depend on the law. Abraham was also not circumcised until long after his adoption by God, and that was just as a sign or seal of his adoption, not a requirement of it. So Paul says, for the promise that he would inherit the world, that is to Abraham, did not come to Abraham or his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. It is the faith which Abraham shows in God, which will justify him and make him right with God. God tells him that he will be the father of multitudes. And although Abraham finds that hard to believe, as he's old, very old, and so is his wife Sarah, he's prepared to go along with what God says. Abraham's faith in God is so strong that later in Genesis, he will nearly sacrifice his own son Isaac, because God tests him and asks him to do so. Paul wants the Roman Christians to know that faith is the most important part of being a Christian, not keeping the Jewish law. He says, if it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. He's saying that if keeping the law is the only route to salvation, then what do you need faith for? Just follow the rules and regulations, and you don't need to bother about believing in Jesus. The promise to Abraham would depend not on his faith in God, but on what he did and how he acted. And that promise would be useless, because people can never keep all the laws. They will always fail, and so will never be redeemed and justified, and will never be made right with God. Thankfully, Abraham's and our own justification and salvation does not rely on adherence to the law. It relies on only one thing: the redeeming death and resurrection of Jesus as the Son of God. When Jesus died on the cross, he took our sins onto himself. And when he rose again on Easter Day, he justified us and made us right with God. Paul says, therefore, his faith, that's Abraham's faith, was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now, the words "it was reckoned to him" were written not for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in him who raised Jesus, our Lord, from the dead, who was handed over to death for our trespasses, and was raised for our justification. Abraham's faith was credited to him, and he was treated as if he was righteous, not through anything he did, but because he believed in God. Righteousness was a gift, not an attainment. We can have that same confidence that through faith we will be treated as righteous because of Jesus and his sacrifice on the cross. We could never be good enough or worthy enough to earn salvation, and we do not need to try. All we have to do is believe in God, believe in Jesus who died for us, and believe in the Holy Spirit. We have been given the gift of eternal life through Jesus dying and rising. And all we have to do is accept it. Amen. Jesus, Saviour of the world, come to us in your mercy. We look to you to save and help us. By your cross and your life laid down, you set your people free. We look to you to save and help us. When they were ready to perish, you saved your disciples. We look to you to come to our help. In the greatness of your mercy, loose us from our chains. Forgive the sins of all your people. Make yourself known as our Saviour and mighty Deliverer. Save and help us that we may praise you. Come now and dwell with us, Lord Christ Jesus. Hear our prayer and be with us always. And when you come in your glory, make us to be one with you and to share the life of your kingdom. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. We now say our creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We now come to a time of prayer. The Collect for the second Sunday of Lent. Almighty God, by the prayer and discipline of Lent, may we enter into the mystery of Christ's sufferings, and by following in his way, come to share in his glory. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And during our intercessions, there'll be pauses so that you can bring anyone you want to into the prayers. High and holy God, robed in majesty, Lord of heaven and earth, we pray that you will bring justice, faith, and salvation to all peoples. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. You choose us in Christ to be your people and to be the temple of your Holy Spirit. We pray that you will fill your church with vision and hope. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Your Spirit enables us to cry, Abba, Father, and affirms that we are fellow heirs with Christ and pleased for us in our weakness. We pray for all who are in need or distress. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. In the baptism and birth of Jesus, you have opened heaven to us and enabled us to share in your glory. The joy of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit from before the world was made. May your whole church, living and departed, come to a joyful resurrection in your city of light. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Let us commend ourselves and all for whom we pray to the mercy and protection of God. Amen. And we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. May God, our Redeemer, show us compassion and love. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Good day.